Let's try it now. Okay. Welcome. We're so glad. Anyway, we have a couple of announcements that are on the screen here. The first one is the Wednesday night, Sunday night. We have that going on. And then for youth group, we have our Wednesday night kids program at 7, and we're going to have a bunch of fun with them. We have Christmas Eve at 5, candlelight service that will be here. All of you are invited to join us. We are also planning on live streaming that if you can't make it. And then we have church next Sunday. So we hope that this week will be a blessing to you, not just because Jesus Christ is born, but may it be a blessing through the different relationships and the different connections you make this week with family and friends. So there's with that, let's stand. And we are going to be singing some Christmas carols. And remember, not only are these nostalgic, but these are praises to our Almighty God, who we celebrate that he loves us so much that he would come from the throne room of heaven down to earth to show us how we can be saved. Let's worship our God today.
What child is this who lay to rest on Mary's lap is sleeping, whom angels greet with anthems sweet, while shepherds watch are keeping? God's garden angels sing. This is Christ the King of Faith, the Son of Mary. So bring him incense, gold and myrrh, compensating to own him, the King of Kings. Salvation brings, let loving hearts enthrone him. This is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing. Yes, this is Christ, the King of Faith, the Son of Mary. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and mountain, that Jesus Christ is born. While shepherds kept their watching for silent flocks by night, behold, throughout the heavens there shone a holy light. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. The shepherds will not tremble when low above the earth rang out the angel chorus that hailed the Savior's birth. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. Down in a lowly manger, the humble Christ was born. And God sent us salvation that blessed Christmas morn. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born.
Woo!
Amen. Oh, holy night, the stars are brightly shining. It is the night of the dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and error mourning, till he appeared and the soul felt its worth. A thrill of world rejoices, for yonder breaks a new and glorious morn. Fall on your knees, O hear the angel voices, O God, Christ was born. Oh, holy night, oh, night divine. Truly he taught us to love one another. His love and his gospel is peace. Chains shall he break, for the slave is our brother. In his name worship shall cease. Sweet hymns of joy in painful glorious raise me, let all within us praise his holy name. Christ is the Lord. Oh, praise his name forever. There's power and glory evermore proclaim his power.
Want to join? Feel free.
The scarlet Christmas lights reveal to us the price he paid, in giving all his life and death the way to God is made.
The greens remind us of his love in making life forever, that we who trust him may be sure that he'll forsake us never.
The blues speak of eternity, The blues speak of eternity, the never-ending span, the timeless age and numbered years according to his plan.
The most beautiful of all tells of his righteousness. a robe of snowy spotless white, and faith ours to possess.
The trees deck the windows bright, a star and twinkling bell. The gifts are made, the carols are played, do not the story tell.
He came to die and not to live. We worship not the child, but God incarnate. Holy, great, not virgin, but infant mild.
We cannot worship above nor manders filled with hay.
Not even a cross made out of wood.
Rich in the sky that day.
But Christ alone, for he is God, he's all we'll ever need. Remember not his birth alone, for in his word we read.
This do in memory of me. His death for this he came, his body broken, bleeding sore, he hung in blinding shame.
The sun refused to shine at noon, the darkness fell as night. The temple veil was rent in twain, God spurned this prince of light.
On him was sin, all yours and mine, a black and ugly guilt. The world's light died, it's done, he cried, his precious blood is spilled.
It's crimson red, it's giving life, we have in faith believed it. For sinners, we cannot be free because we have received it.
Christmas lights of red and green.
Christmas lights of red and green.
Of amber, blue, and white.
Of amber, blue, and white.
We look beyond the lovely scene.
We look beyond the lovely scene.
To God, our Christmas light.
To God, our Christmas light.
Little Lord Jesus laid down his sweet head. The stars in the sky looked down where he lay. The little Lord Jesus asleep on the hay.
The kettle Lord Jesus, no crying he makes. I love thee, Lord Jesus, look down from the sky and stay by my cradle till morning is nigh. Jesus, I ask thee to stay. The sky be forever and love me, I pray. Bless all the dear children in thy tender care. And take us to heaven to live with thee there.
Everybody, good to see so many here and so many smiley faces. I'm a little bit jittery this morning. I don't know if it's Marie's music or too much of Nancy Hosley's fudge, but anyway, I'm a little bit hyper today. Anyway, our reading, our Old Testament reading, is from Isaiah 40, verses 1:4 and 5. And it says this, comfort my people, says your God. Every valley shall be raised up, every mountain and hill made low. The rough ground shall become level, and the rugged places a plain. And the glory of the Lord will be revealed, and all people will see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. And our New Testament reading is from the second chapter of Hebrews. And I got my papers mixed up here. Anyway, okay, chapter 2, verses 10, 11, and 14 and 15. In bringing many sons and daughters to glory, it was fitting that God, for whom and through whom everything exists, should make the pioneer of their salvation perfect through what he suffered. Both the one who makes people holy and those who are made holy are of the same family. So Jesus is not ashamed to call them brothers and sisters. Since the children have flesh and blood, he too shared in their humanity, so that by his death he might break the power of him who holds the power of death, that is the devil, and free those who all their lives were held in slavery by their fear of death. Fear of death has never been a very popular subject for people, even Christians. My question, do you live in slavery from fear of death? I know some do. Don't be, because we have Christmas. And we celebrate Christmas because we have Easter. See, without Christmas, there would be no Easter, no resurrection, no hope, no joy, no celebration. When you're baptized into Christ, we see and feel, as Apostle Paul put it, the power of his resurrection. And this brings us great joy, knowing that there's a resurrection for all of us through Christ. Do you know what's really important to God? You are, every one of you. You know why? Because his image is on us. His image is on you. You're not a random product of science, like some would have you believe. You're created in the image of God. Over 3 billion letters in your individual DNA alphabet. Psalms 139:15 and 16 says this, my frame was not hidden from thee when I was made in secret and skillfully wrought in the depths of the earth. Thine eyes have seen the unformed substance, and in thy book they were all written, the days that were ordained for me, when as yet there was not one of them. If we go back to our text in Hebrews and go down to verse 17, it says this, therefore he, Jesus that is, had to be made like his brethren in all things, that he might become merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make atonement for the sins of the people. See, Jesus Christ was both the sacrifice, the sin offering, and the high priest that offered it. So as we take the bread and the cup today, let us remember that Jesus is the high priest of our confession. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you're a merciful and compassionate God. We thank you that you sent your Son to die for us, to resurrect us, that we can have confidence in Jesus Christ and what he did and what he said. Remind us in our hearts to celebrate Christmas every day of the year, and to remember the power of his resurrection. In Jesus' name we pray. Take the bread and the cup. This is body given up for us. and the drink, just as the blood of the new covenant shed for you and for me for the forgiveness of sins.
Would you join me as we go to our Lord in prayer for our congregational prayer today? Heavenly Father, make us aware of your presence in our lives and purify our hearts and minds. We pray that we would find our identity in our home and your Son, Jesus Christ, as we await the day of his appearing. Sustain us, Lord. Shape us by the power of your Spirit. Thank you for the grace and mercy that you have given to us, and lead us away from temptation. Please deliver us from evil. Forgive us of our sins, and give us the grace and courage to forgive others as you have forgiven us. And Lord, as we lift up the needs of our community and the people in our church, Lord, we lift up to you Marion Cooper. Lord, we pray for her as she's frustrated that the surgery that was scheduled for Friday was started but could not be completed because of her heart. Lord, we're thankful that she is doing better, but Lord, we pray for the additional doctor's appointments that she's going to need so that she can have the surgery done and her pain alleviated. Lord, thank you for carrying her through what she described as the most painful time of her life. By your word, by others praying for you, and even by someone humming Silent Night. Lord, thank you for your presence in her life. Lord, we pray for Bo. As this week he had his eye removed, and Lord, we thank you that it went well, and we just pray for continued recovery. Lord, we pray for so many people that are getting together this Christmas time. Lord, we pray that the times together might be times of joy and of peace. Lord, and we also pray for healing of any relationships that are broken, that this Christmas time might bring healing and unity to that time. Lord, we pray for Julie Kopp and her dad who are going through COVID, amongst many others. Lord, we pray for Julie's dad as it seems that COVID seems to be taking his life soon. Lord, we pray for their comfort and for your mercy. And Lord, we pray for our nation. We pray that you might bring unity. Lord, we pray for wisdom, godly wisdom upon our leaders. And Lord, we pray for our missionaries that are around the world and those who serve our country. We pray that while they are away from family and friends, that you might be their encouragement, that you might be their peace and their joy. And Lord, thank you for your promise to be with us, your people. Give us an awareness of your presence with us today. And when we are frightened, guard our hearts and minds with the peace of Christ Jesus. Protect us from discouragement. Encourage us by your Holy Spirit, through your word, through your people, your promises, and all that is beautiful and true. Through Jesus Christ we pray, amen. Right now the worship ministry, the worship team has prepared some Christmas music for us to enjoy.
Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place was no doubt the thought that was on the minds of the ones who came to visit the baby Jesus on that Christmas night. As the shepherds made their way through the night, following the light of the star, Joseph and Mary huddled in a small place where they had just welcomed their new baby into the world. Entertaining or preparing for visitors was probably not on the minds of Joseph and Mary that particular time. However possible it may be, the existence of a little boy with a drum who came to play a song for Jesus may be very unlikely. There may very well have been visitors other than the shepherds to the stable that night, but most mothers of newborns would prefer silence, not the rum-tum-tum on a drum near their sleeping child. However, any musical offering that would direct our thoughts towards the birth and the life of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, is a good song. the little drummer boy, correctly pointing to the humble nature of Christ's birth as a way to identify with him, I am a poor boy too. We ourselves may not have great gifts to offer, but striving to give our best is all he asks, for he is worthy. As we celebrate this holiday this year, and what a year it certainly has been, please keep in mind where it all began.
His grace. I can hear the brush of angels' wings. I see glory on its face. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place.
There's a holy hush around us. As God's glory fills his place, I've touched the hem of his garment. I can almost see his face. And my heart is overflowing with the fullness of his joy. I know without a doubt. I've been with the Lord.
Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel its mighty power and its grace.
Thank you.
my sermon up there. Crown him with many crowns, the Lamb upon the throne. You see, it's so hard to think that God is so great and grand when we see a babe in the manger. It's so hard to understand the impact and the magnitude of this small event that we so often take for granted. How often does a whole community celebrate a birth? The New Year's baby, right? But other than that, it's like some royalty somewhere or some star that has a kid named Pepsi or something. I don't know. You see, it's just one of those things where we don't pay attention to birth unless you're close, intimate, or you know that person, because it's such a humble event. And yet, because it's God, it becomes an event that is supposed to be remembered and worshiped for all eternity. For God has come in the flesh to save us from our sins, our wrongdoings, our past, the things that we're filled with shame and regret about. God says, I will come. And as the scripture said in Isaiah that Kim wrote, I'll flatten your path, I'll take out the obstacles, and I'll make your life better. That's the promise that Jesus gives to us. It's so humble, yet so powerful. There's another person that's extremely humble in the Christmas story. His name is Joseph. We've been going through this series of all is calm and all is bright. And in the chaos of this world in which we live, we just want kind of a taste of something that's calm and something that's bright. And so this week, we're going to look at the life of Joseph. And as we look at the life of Joseph, we see a man who is humble, yet very strong. I remember going to Nazareth a couple years ago when we took a trip. There's a group of us that went to Israel. And I remember going in the Nazareth, and there's this great big cathedral in there they believe is the place where Mary heard from the angel. And then you go up the hill a little bit, and then there's this kind of the small little chapel. That's for Joseph. And so you have this big thing with Mary and with the announcement, and then you have this little chapel with Joseph. But on the way back down the hill, on the way to our bus, you could go right along the chapel, or you could kind of divert to the right. And there is this, I don't know, 9-foot statue kind of set by itself. And it has pillars around it. And here is this man of a statue. And it's kind of green. You know how that happens with the bronze and whatnot. And so anyway, it was kind of brown. But there is one spot on there that was still shiny. It was his knee. And you look at the face. Look at the face of the sculpture, and it's filled with humility. The eyes are so kind, they're inviting. And as my friend and his wife were walking by, they had to stop because of the peace that was so present in that place that they started to cry. And I took the short way, you know, I was heading back to the bus. They go, Jeremy, you got to head up there. And I had went up there, and the whole group was behind me. And as a leader, you're not supposed to be the last one there, you know? So I'm like, okay, God. Yeah, cool. Okay. But as I reflected on it, I can't forget that face. Because that face just exuded this idea of humility and yet strength. You see, we pick up in the Christmas story in Luke chapter 1, and this is Joseph's part of the story. We start at verse 18. It says this. This is how the birth of Jesus the Messiah came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph. But before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. And all this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. And when Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. But he did not consummate their marriage until she gave birth to a son, and they gave him the name Jesus. Why was Joseph so important to this story? Because Joseph is the epitome of integrity. You see, if we go back and we look at Mary, we see this humility, this humble servant, as you say, Lord, I will do, knowing that her life has taken a wicked change in trajectory. This life of living a nice, quiet, humble life in the small town of this young mother, now being accused, becoming pregnant outside of marriage, losing honor in her family, and wondering if Joseph would ever accept her. She said, yes, I will do that. But Joseph takes a different path. You see, Joseph takes the path of integrity through this whole thing. And I want us to see his integrity, because his integrity is the strength to the story. You see, but first we have to ask what integrity is. Integrity is one, what one believes and what one does is the same thing. What one believes and what one does is the same thing. That's how we say it. Well, you can trust him, honor on his word, right? His word is honor. Or all these other ways in which they're responsible. If they said they're going to do it, they're going to do it. I can trust them because they don't lie. Whatever it is, it's that realm of if they say they're going to do it, or if that's what they believe, that's what they're going to stand in. But yet there are some people who believe things that aren't godly. There are some people who will say, I'm not going to do that. And they are honest, right? Or they will say something that doesn't honor God. Is that integrity? Well, they're being consistent. But the question is not being a person of integrity. The question is whether you are a person of godly integrity. You see, there's a difference there. Godly integrity says, I'm going to do the thing that God wants me to do. I'm going to do the thing that God desires me to do. You see, as a follower of God, integrity becomes this. If I trust God's way, I will do things God's way. It's pretty simple. If I trust God's way, I will do things God's way. You see, all this comes down to this idea of what the idea of being a Lord is. So when I get together with people and we start talking and we talk about whatever they want to talk about, and as I'm discipling them, what counseling or whatever it is, when we start with this one idea, what does Lord mean? What does Lord mean? And I have found that about 95% of the people say Lord means he's really big. He's almighty. He's powerful. He's the king. He's on the throne. Yes and no. Yes, he has authority. Yes, he has that right. He does have that power. But lordship isn't just believing that God's on a throne. Lordship is believing that God's on his throne and I'm going to follow him. You see, Lord means I'm going to follow the ways that God wants me to go. Lord says, I trust his way, so I'm going to do it his way. That's what lordship means. I like to call it life leader or boss or king. Having Jesus as your Lord means, yep, he says this, I do this. Because I trust him in his way. Now, Joseph, he trusted God's way. And we're going to see how he trusted God's way through the whole story. So we're going to start with how did Joseph follow God's ways before the angel? This is how he followed God's ways before the angel. Number one, he decided he had to be a person of godly integrity. So what did he do? He decided to divorce Mary. Whoa, divorce. Okay. But she's only pledged. She's engaged. How can you be engaged and not divorced? Well, this is how it worked back then. Much different. A guy would say, I would like to marry her. So he goes to the house of the father of the bride he hopes to have. And there he talks with the father. And the father is saying, so how are you going to support her? You see, some things don't change, right? But there's another part. Because she's leaving that household and might not ever return, she has value to that house that where a son's going to stay there, the daughter will leave. And so what happens is this thing called a dowry. So the son and possibly the father will get together and say, we would like to give you this money, a dowry, for the bride, because we know that this will cause hardship on your family because she will not be there to do her part of the family chores. And so they would offer goats, sheep, money, whatever it was, they would offer that. And so there would be a decision made. And what would happen is the father would say, yes, you can marry my daughter. And the groom goes, yippee, I got work to do. And so he would go to his house, and usually what would happen is once you were pledged to be married, now you had to find a home. But the home wasn't someplace off, or it was actually attached to the house of the parents, because the families lived in intergenerational housing. In other words, I got to go build a room onto the side of mom and dad's house. And so what would happen is the groom would go and start building a room for him and his wife. In the meantime, the bride would stay with mom and dad until the arrangements have been set and made. But when the father accepts the dowry and says, yes, you two are pledged to be married, guess what? They were considered all in married. The only way to break that covenant that has been made is through divorce. And Joseph had been diligently preparing a place for Mary, getting everything ready, so busy. And then he hears, she what? I've been working hard and she did what? How does this work? And what happens is there is this realization of Joseph with the information that he's been given. I don't think Mary's been faithful to me. Which means that he has the right to divorce her, according to law, because she broke covenant, broke the agreement, broke the promise of being faithful to only that person. And because of that, he decides, I am going to go and divorce her. That was what a godly man would do. Because another part of godliness is your reputation, doing what is right. And so he decides to do that. But the other thing that he does is this. Because he's a man of integrity, and because he wants to follow God, things God's way, he's going to treat people with respect and love. You see, so often we say, if you're not doing it God's way, get out of my way. But you see, he sees that when I do things God's way, I have to do it the right way. You see, people do things God's way, and they do it the wrong way. What? You did this? Done. I'm done with you. I'm moving on. And that's not the right way. While there might be truth and that might be the way it is, that's not necessarily the right way. And because he understands that God is a God that sees everyone as valuable, as everyone that deserves respect and love, he decides he's going to divorce Mary quietly. He doesn't want her to be looked down upon. He doesn't want people to attack her. He doesn't want to make a great big public spectacle. Because when you go to divorce someone in that day, you go to the city's gate and you make this announcement before all the elders saying, I want a divorce. What's your proof? And then they bring whatever proof they have, and then it will be granted in front of all the comings and goings at the gate of the city. But he was going to try to get the elders on the side. Hey, you know, she's just really nice. She made a mistake, but we're done. You see, sometimes when we want to do things God's way, it doesn't mean that we can do it anyway. If we do things God's way, we have to do it the right way. The right way always includes love and respect. Looking at a person, no matter if they're male or female, no matter what color of skin, no matter what age they might be, you look at them with the same love that God looks at them, and you treat them the right way, because that's God's way. So that was Joseph's plan. Joseph's plan got a little bit of a hiccup, because one night he had a dream and an angel came to him and said, this is the new information. What's the new information? This baby is part of God's plan and you need to stick with her because this is God's way. And so how does Joseph respond God's way
after the angel? Well, the first thing he realizes is this child is part of God's plan, which means I'm going to stay. And the second thing is, Mary will be my wife, and therefore, I'm going to wait on the honeymoon. Because a lot of times the honeymoon is something that's really looked forward to. But Joseph is like, no. I am not going to mess up anything. I'm going to stay out of God's way. I'm going to make sure nobody second guesses my or anything like this. I'm going to hold back. And I believe the angel might have, that dream might have included that, but they didn't put it in there. Because what I know about guys, from counting them and reading books, of course, is that. All right, moving on. So this child is God's plan. So I'm going to stay in this relationship, even though it's not perfect, even though it doesn't fit the regular schedule of how things work, it doesn't matter because this is God's plan. So I'm going to do. Why? Because I trust God's way, therefore I will do God's way. Even when it's hard. You see, this is one of the problems that we have so often. We have this theology of the open door. If the door is open and it's easy, God must be blessing it. I don't know if you realize this, but Satan sometimes can open the door that you aren't supposed to go through. You see, sometimes when you need to do things God's way, it's not the easy way. Sometimes it's the hard way. Sometimes it's the way in which you will receive ridicule and hardship. And I want you to realize that is exactly what was going through Joseph's mind and what was going through Joseph and Mary's life. You see, Mary left and stayed with Elizabeth for 3 months. Why? Because Nazareth was only about a town of 150. Yes, there are places smaller than Sheldon. Oh, wait, we know that. We live in Russ County. Right. Okay. So it's just a small little town. You don't think they heard about Mary? Yeah, thank you. So exactly. They knew about Mary. And then Joseph knew. Joseph was a tradesman. If he brought dishonor to a family, there was a good chance that he would lose work. Oh, that Joseph. Huh. Did you hear about him and Mary? And what's Joseph going to say? It's not my child, it's God's. That doesn't help his argument anymore. Right? And so anyway, what happens, and we're going to hit this next Sunday a little bit, but I want you to see the picture of how hard this road was going to be. At the census, they go down to Bethlehem for Jesus to be born. The wise men come probably 18 to 24 months later. It wasn't the night of the birth. Well, guess what? They lived in Bethlehem for those 18 to 24 months. Why didn't they go back to their home in Nazareth? Then all of a sudden, Herod's going to kill all the babies in the area. So they pick up and they go to Egypt. And they stay in Egypt until they get a plan. You can go back. And what was their plan? Their plan was to go back to Bethlehem. Why would they go back to Nazareth? That's where they're from. And they ended up going back to Nazareth because Archelaus, the king that took over Herod the Great, his son, was just as crazy as Herod the Great. And they're like, oh, we don't want to mess with that. So we're going to go back to Nazareth. Nazareth was the last place they wanted to go. Nazareth was the last place. Why? Because they knew the road that it would be because they had a mark on their door, a mark on their reputation that, oh, those two couldn't wait. Oh, they didn't do it God's way. When in fact, they did. You see, sometimes God's way is not the easy way. But if I'm going to be a follower of God, I will trust God's way, which means I will do God's way. So what does that mean for us? It means that I can live God's way because he is the way. John 14, 6 says this. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and life. No one can come to the Father except through me. Jesus makes this simple proclamation, this statement of truth. If you want to get to the Father, if you want to get to God, guess what? You have to go through me. So pick my way. And Jesus said his way is narrow because it's not always the easy way. And then Jesus says this, I am the truth. If you want to know what's right and wrong, follow the words that I have. Follow me. And I am the life. If you want to live life to where you feel complete and fulfilled, follow me as well. Jesus says, I am the way for you to have life, for you to know what's right and wrong, but also for you to understand how to live. You see, if Jesus is the way and I follow that and I understand that if I trust his will and his way, I do his will, how does that bring us calm and bright? Because usually I'm talking about hard ways. That's not calm, Jeremy. That's not bright. That sounds hard and difficult. Why would I ever want to do this? Because it is calm and bright. You see, it is calm. I have calm when I trust his way over my way. You see, once I take his way over my way, there's actually a calm because I understand this is the right way. Look at this picture. Okay. You see, it's all about perspective. Okay, here we have a little zebra underneath the rain clouds, getting rained on, and it's just like, it's not a very happy day for the zebra. Is the giraffe experiencing rain? He is. His whole body's getting wet, right? But his head is out of the clouds and he sees the sun. He sees that the day isn't all that bad. He sees that the sun is still shining even though the circumstance below is hard and difficult. You see, we are so good at just dwelling in the ugly and the frustration of this life that we don't put on the right perspective that God's way actually is the right way. You see, so often we have this attitude, which is this cartoon that I'd like to share with you. It's pretty serious, so don't laugh. This toothbrush says, sometimes I feel that I have the worst job in the world. And the toilet paper says, yeah, right. You see, it's so easy for us just to get stuck and think that our life is miserable. God's way is just horrible. Why would I ever want to take on that pain or that frustration or that hardship? And yet God says, no, no, no. Jesus took the hard way so we could have the easier way and the way that gives us life. You see, my life is bright because I trust his way over my way. I trust that he's the one that actually gives me hope, that he actually gives me understanding. He helps me. He sees things. And so all of a sudden I can reframe things up, rather than that person is really mean to me at work versus God, I'm just going to follow you. And however people treat me, doesn't matter because I follow you first. Because you love me more than anybody can love me. You love me more than my mommy. You love me more than my kids. You love me more than fill in the blank. Because God loves you. And you see, when we understand who God is, that he's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, that he's immortal, he's the scripture says he's actually unapproachable. Guess what happens? I start to trust his because I'm too often the zebra and God is the giraffe seeing over all the difficulty of my life. And I have to trust the giraffe or I have to trust God to lead me to the place where there's sun and hope. That's why my life can have calm. But how can my life be bright? My life can be bright when I realize God sees my trust in him. Go down three. One more. Oh, wait, you went too far. One more. Up. Oh, it's not there. Well, isn't that a surprise? Well, let me tell you what it is, okay? All right. I am bright when I realize God sees my trust in me. Don't think that all my efforts are in vain. Don't think that God doesn't see what's going on because so often God sees you. In fact, the Old Testament says that when it comes to God, all my thoughts and all my actions, everything about me is naked before the eyes of God. God sees everything. You cannot hide anything. That's a little daunting until you realize God's love for you as he wraps you up in his arms and loves you, even though he sees all of that. And you see, my life is bright because I realize God's way. As I live that out, he sees me. Jesus did this big sermon in the Sermon on the Mount, and he says these four things in that sermon. In Matthew 6, he's saying, what kind of reward do you want? Because I have to have a reward if I'm going to put myself out there. I want to know that God sees me. I want to know there's a purpose because I don't like to do things just because they're painful. I don't think that I'm the only one. This is what Jesus says. Matthew 6, verses 3 and 4. But when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing so that your giving may be in secret. Then your Father who sees what is done is in secret will reward you. Even though you don't tell anybody, he still sees it. Verse 6, when you pray, go into your room, close a door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. You don't have to tell people that. You pray all the time. Let that be between you and God. He sees what you're doing. Verse 17 and 18, when you fast, put oil on your head and wash your face so that it will not be obvious to others that you are fasting, but only to your Father in heaven who is unseen, and your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward. God sees when you're doing things for him. He sees when you give. He sees when you love others. He sees when you say no. And he sees when you say yes, even though it might not be something you want to say yes to. You see, I can do the right thing trusting God's way when I realize God sees me trusting in him. And even when it's hard, Matthew 5, 11 and 12, Jesus says, blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kind of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. Joseph was a man who did the right thing to the best of his ability. Was he perfect? Absolutely not. He was a guy. He was a human. But he trusted God's way, and then he lived God's way. Which way are you heading right now? It might not be an easy path ahead of you, but it is a better path. It might be a path in which you haven't really regarded or even thought about, but it's a path that gives you life and it gives you truth. It gives you freedom and it gives you hope. It gives you calm in the midst of chaos, and it gives you bright hope in the midst of hardship, because Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. So what do you need to trust Jesus with this week? What is he calling you to? Is it a coworker? Is it a financial decision? Is it a relationship? What do you need to do to humble yourself? What do you need to do to follow his way? And if you do that, God is good. And he will help you. And he will guide you. And he will never stop loving you. So today, this Christmas, pick Jesus's way. Trust him and trust the path that he has before you. It might bring hardship, but it will always bring joy, knowing that you are in the will of the Father. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for giving us the example of Joseph, realizing that if we humble ourselves and do the way in which you have called us to do, Lord, there is a calm, there is a peace that resides in us following you, but there's also a joy knowing that our hope is in you. You don't ignore us. You see us as we are, and you beckon, you call us to something more. So Lord, as whatever's going through our mind right now of the things we need to change, something that we need to trust in you, Lord, give us the courage and the strength to do that. Just as the angel told Joshua, be strong and courageous. Do not fear, for I, the Lord God, am with you wherever you go. May we be strong and courageous, forging ahead, whether it's putting our faith in you and just saying, Jesus, I really want to follow your way. All the way to saying, Jesus, I've gotten off the path. I'm going to start following your way. Or maybe those who have been on the way, Lord, when it comes to that decision, may I do the right thing. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. If you need a relationship with Jesus Christ, I invite to talk to you, because I want you to realize how awesome it is to follow Jesus. If you want to get baptized, which is this beautiful union between you and your Savior, and you have not been immersed or dunked into the water and want to be, please talk to me. I think it is one of the most amazing spiritual experiences that you will have. And I would love to talk to you about that. In fact, Christmas Eve, we're going to have someone baptized. So the water will be ready if you would like to be baptized this Christmas Eve or any time after that. Or some of you, you're doing great, but you just need prayer. If you would like prayer, there'll be somebody up here in the front, and they would be willing to pray with you if you need prayer for this Christmas season. And with that, let's stand, and we'll close with a benediction. One little announcement. There will be no Sunday school next week as well. No Sunday school next week as well. So, all right, let's... close in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come to you. And Lord, may we walk in your way wherever it leads, because we trust you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Have a great week. See you next week.